Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents In the Ruins by Lilith Saintcrow, narrated by Erin deWard. Life Lesson. This particular Best Western, 3 miles from Lewiston, was dark and empty, but an employee door tucked in a northern corner was easy enough to jimmy open. At least, it seemed easy when Lee and Juju did it, and Ginny Miles couldn't decide if they seemed altogether too practiced at the maneuver, or if they were just handy enough it wasn't a problem. "Built to keep the honest people out," Lee remarked, and Juju's grin in response made him look years younger. From inside, they could manually open the sliding glass doors in the front. Fire codes were probably a thing of the past, too, now that the world had ended. "Coast to coast," the man on the news had said. The illness raged like a wildfire. Fever, flu, convulsions, coma, and the horrid grinding, growling while the infected chewed everything they could. Everything, but most especially anything living. The hotel foyer was eerily tidy, a curved check-in desk standing empty and dark. The only sign of something not right, aside from the lack of electricity, was a vase of wilted lilies under a large logo made of cheap pasteboard and glass. Steph Meacham held onto Ginny's arm so tightly she was going to leave a bruise or two, but Ginny didn't have the heart to shake free. Instead, she studied the large, shadow-filled space. No bar. No attached restaurant. Just an expanse of blue and orange carpet left over from the 70s and an alcove with the blank steel faces of two elevators, useless without power. Had they failed with someone inside? Or in the cities? In the skyscrapers? Had it happened all at once, or by degrees? How long had it taken for the world to fall apart? Had Cotton Crossing been bumbling along like Ginny herself in the duplex, chaos and blood spattering on the other side of thin drywall as her neighbors died? "Rooms on the second floor, at least." Juju Thurgood rubbed at the back of his left hand, where a shiny burn scar gleamed against the brown skin. His blue-knit cap had a cheerful pom-pom on top, bobbing as he glanced around, the same quick scan Lee used to gauge likely danger. His breath showed, a thin cloud, even though it was much warmer in here without the wind.
"Safer. And we'd best take 'em together." Yeah.
Lee Quartine, lean and dark-eyed in a fatigue jacket over a tan sweater, ran stiff fingers through his sandy hair and glanced incuriously at the small bell on the counter. A mass-produced sign sat next to it, hard red plastic with white engraving. "Please ring for service." Nobody was going to be ringing for service for a while, Ginny thought. Traveler trotted away to investigate this new cave the humans had decided to shelter in. The blue-tick coonhound's tail worked furiously, his nose to the carpet, untangling a smorgasbord of aromas. Doggy heaven. It was the little things that disturbed her. No lights in house windows, stores with their doors ajar or their windows broken and snow spilled across goods pulled almost free, left midway. When rural peeled away and suburban pressed close, it wasn't so bad, but several strip malls clustering the highway showed signs of looting. No other cars in sight, though there were tracks on the rimmed, salt-treated roads. The wreckage of a few abandoned checkpoints had been clear of at least one lane each time, but there was no guarantee that would keep happening along the way. They'd have to start driving on the shoulder or median soon, which gave Ginny all sorts of heebie-jeebies. If she'd been in her Toyota, she wouldn't have made it even this far. Cotton Crossing had slept while the rest of the country broke apart. Coast to coast, the sweating man on the public broadcast station said before the signal cut out. Somehow it was this empty hotel foyer that made it seem, well, not just possible, but like a done deal. Her back ached from jolting in the truck all day. Ginny studied the clunky chairs not truly meant for lounging. Polite fictions, a pretense that a hotel wasn't tiny boxes stacked on top of each other. Apartments, hotels, office buildings, clusters of boxes, all of them. Even her duplex was individual rooms fitted together. Domestic Legos.
Miss Virginia.
Lee's voice broke across her thoughts, and he was looking at her, stubble softening the hard line of his jaw. He looked a lot better without his usual baseball cap and with his buzz cut growing out.
What do you think?
Huh? Her scalp itched. Were there magazines on the tiny tables between the uncomfortable, overstuffed, and probably bored hard chairs? Would there be magazines ever again, at least in her lifetime, if this thing was not just American but worldwide? We have reports from other countries, too. Sorry, what? If her inattention bothered him, he didn't show it.
You want a room with Steph there, or on your own?
God, she wanted to channel Garbo and be alone. But the blue-eyed girl clutched a little tighter at Ginny's arm with gloved fingers, and her babble in Lee's red-and-white truck, mile after mile of it, had burned itself into Ginny's brain.
My daddy, he's making this sound, and he ran right out at the truck, half his face gone, and my mama.
Sobbing little breaths, the girl trying to process the damn near unprocessable. I think we girls should pair up, Ginny said after a long pause. Steph relaxed, her grasp loosening a little and her thin, fine hair wildly mussed. I may even have some nail polish in my luggage. We'll have a slumber party.
We'll skip the face masks and the giggling about boys, though.
Lee's gaze, piercing even in the cold semi-darkness, warmed. He gave a short, sharp nod, and ridiculously enough, the small bit of approval eased the knot behind Ginny's breastbone.
Bite.
Stretching the words all right over a few syllables and dropping everything in its middle, like everyone did around here.
Mark, you stay near the door there. Keep Trav with you, and you keep your eyes peeled. Juju. You want to come with me to see about a Ginny or such?
Getting Juju's nod, he turned back to Ginny and Steph.
You want to find us good rooms? Near the stairs, I'm thinking. End of a hall.
Ginny nodded. What if?
What if there are more of them?
Of course, Lee got there ahead of her.
Run away. Run down here and start screaming. That'll bring us in a hurry. Amen to that.
Mark Casbrook, his dark eyes smudged with sleeplessness, muttered. It was on the tip of Ginny's tongue to ask if maybe, just maybe, she should be armed. But the thought of a gun made her unsteady and queasy at once. Maybe something like a baseball bat. She thought it over, decided Steph was nervous enough to bludgeon Ginny if things got scrambled and more of the infected showed up, and that running was probably, all things considered, the best strategy. That makes sense, she said dully. It was taking her too long to plod from one thought to the next. Oh, first we should check, though.
For what?
Juju shifted from foot to foot, probably eager to find a bathroom. Maybe the pipes weren't frozen here. Now that was an encouraging thought. Ginny patted at Steph's grasp on her arm, trying to comfort the teenager and probably failing miserably. To see if this place has updated. If it's changed to key cards, the doors might not work, except from inside the rooms.
They sell batteries,
Steph piped up, her blue gaze brightening. Thin tendrils of her hair, somewhere between blonde and brown, shifting colors as the light hit it, stuck to her forehead.
If it's key cards. When we went to Florida, there was a red light on our door, and they told Daddy it was the low battery light.
I didn't know that. Ginny's face unfroze. What kind of expression had she been wearing? A normal one, she hoped. Now she was smiling. The pleasure of learning something new, though muted, was still considerable. A sharpish smell of disuse had already filled the entire foyer. Never mind, then. We'll figure it out. Go ahead. Mark whistled for the dog and headed for the square of gray winter light falling through the door. Beyond the glass, Lee's red and white Chevy and Juju's black 4x4 stood patient and snow-caked on painted stripes under the roof meant to keep Mrs. Whoever and her bags from Pokemo getting rained on. Juju and Lee, both with heavy black flashlights, now those looked useful. They could club the chewing, shuffling things with little trouble, headed off to find a service door. Ginny, her fingers nervous and slick, found the latch securing the little swinging piece of pasteboard that said, "Here is official space," just like the one at the library's checkout counter. God, she would never see Lewiston's Fifth Street Library building again, or the Cotton Crossing branch she worked on Sundays. Never sit through another acquisitions meeting, or sip hot tea in the break room with Annie Collins, or hear her boss Bobby's rolling Appalachian accent. Never going to Street Park on Sundays because Cotton Crossing kids, bored and full of mischief, had filled the library lot with broken glass the night before. Never going to lay out the papers for Elmore Creary, or wish vengefully for his squeaky chair to dump him, or patiently explain how to use the internet to a woman old enough to be her mother. God, how was Mom doing? And Dad, Flo, and the baby? The due date was, good Lord, Ginny didn't even know what day it was. Without her phone or laptop, keeping calendar track wasn't so easy. Would survivors eventually be reduced to stone hinges and counting on their fingers?
Miss Mills?
Steph, anxious, still clutching at her arm.
You okay?
Keep it together, Ginny. She took a deep breath, settling her shoulders, and blinked furiously a few times to get her eyes to focus. Behind the hotel desk, everything looked different. The working side, instead of the customer service facade.
I am,
she lied. Help me find another flashlight back here, sweetie, and we'll look at the floor plan. Steph's wan, sharply pretty face creased, but at least she wasn't as wild-eyed now. Ginny could see a shadow of what the girl would look like when she finished growing, high cheekbones and soft lips.
The floor plan?
Research is always better than going in blind. Ginny wasn't just soothing the teenager, but herself. It was easier to be steady when you had someone else to balance first. Life lesson.
Lots of that going around these days,
Steph said. And after a few shocked moments, their laughter, thin, unsteady but very welcome, made the dark a little less clammy and a whole lot more bearable. Not enough pop.
22 won't stop 'em.
Juju shook his head, the pom-pom on his hat bouncing, while he played the flashlight beam over a gigantic bank of washing machines. The dryers on the other side, each door slightly ajar, were compound eyes peering at these interlopers.
Not enough pop, even with hollow ammo.
Lee Quartine made a noise of assent. He wasn't sure what kind of gun Casper could handle, but Juju had a point. Everyone played with 22s. Even Steph could likely use one. Ginny, though, maybe not, being a city girl and all. Still, she'd been the one thinking to ask what she and Steph should do if they ran across one of the things. The critters. Kasprak called them zombies. It was as good a word as any, but Lee didn't like it. He liked none of this. He had a couple other thoughts rolling around inside his head, but they weren't ready for outside yet. There was one he'd been waiting to broach when he got Juju alone, though.
Guns might not be the best idea.
Huh? Juju's boots squeaked a little. Out where the guests would be, it was all carpeted. Back here, there was no use for luxury, and the floor was bare concrete, worn to a glossy shine.
Uh-huh. Look at that. Hallelujah.
A door labeled electrical gave onto a small room full of circuit breakers and dust.
Them things. Their eyes are caved in. They hear just fine, though.
Lee examined the wall of breakers.
Guns might bring them home for supper.
Juju gave it a few moments of thoughtful silence.
Baseball bat.
He also examined the breakers. Tip had generally been for going in hot to overwhelm problems before they started. Juju favored the take-a-look-first approach, which suited Lee right down to the ground.
Gotta work on my game anyway.
Their boots no longer left damp prints, but he stepped carefully anyway.
You never could tell.
A half snort of a laugh. Juju touched one breaker, another, getting them all clear in his head.
Didn't know you played. Don't. Could stand a start, though.
Lee made up his mind to gamble on a couple switches once Juju gave the all clear.
We may be lucky. Looks like a couple of the mains flipped. Might be juice if we flip 'em back. Not all of them.
Juju pointed, the sleeve of his bomber jacket creaking. A double layer of sweaters underneath it blurred his outline, but he'd never look fat.
Just that one, and that one there. That ought to do it.
Generally, if you wanted to know about the chassis or the propulsion, you asked Tip. If you wanted to know about the wiring, you asked Juju. Lee was a general hand. He liked taking things apart, seeing their innards, and putting them back together. There was a deep itch-scratching satisfaction to making anything work again.
Let's find out.
Two heavy clicks later, a subliminal hum ran through the building. A low orange glow peeked under the door, and when Juju swept the heavy metal rectangle open, emergency lights made Lee's eyes sting a little.
You adapted right quick to darkness.
Humans could adapt to just about anything, just like cockroaches.
Pass the butter,
Juju muttered, sweeping his hat off and jamming it in his pocket.
And give me the goddamn beans,
Lee replied reflexively.
No telling how long it'll last. What else we got here, Mr. Wizard? Give me a second.
Juju eyed the boards. It was damn uncanny, the knack he had for electricals. He was a good teacher when he took a mind to share his expertise, but you couldn't catch genius the way you could cold.
And I'll show you some goddamn magic.
No restaurant, but the room service kitchen was still stocked and functional. Steph brightened at this, and took to ordering Mark Kasprick around with aplomb, shooing the grown-ups away.
We can do this, she said firmly. I'ma teach Mark about a deep fryer.
I know how to open a can of beans,
the shag-haired boy muttered, but he was looking a lot better now. Some color was back in his cheeks, and Lee was thinking it was a good thing Steph was sleeping in Ginny's room. Youngins bounced back from terror damn quick. And if hormones weren't the most powerful force ever invented, they were at least in the top five. Juju decided he'd see if the showers were warm yet and hustled off to find out before Chow, taking Traveler with him. The dog wanted to stay with Ginny, but he was too well trained to complain much. Ginny set off down the long, many times repainted service hall outside the kitchen as if she had some place to be, head down and shoulders up, those pretty but useless boots of hers quiet as snowfall. Lee had to stretch his stride to catch up. Where are you headed? She stopped dead, pitching forward sharply like her legs had decided on it without informing the rest of her. A few buckwheat honey curls worked loose of the two heavy braids wrapped around her head, bounced as she did.
The foyer,
pronounced in that fancy way of hers, foyer.
I thought...
He waited, but she didn't say what she thought. She simply stood, face forward, set and pale, her dark eyes slightly red-rimmed. Come to think of it, she hadn't said much at all, beyond please and thank you, with the notable exceptions of soothing Steph and wondering what the fuck to do if they found critters wandering around upstairs. There were shadows under her pretty dark eyes, too, and that blank stare was one he plain didn't like. Not on her, at least. She shouldn't have to look that way. Ginny. He tried again. Virginia. There was a clatter from the kitchen, and Steph's bright young laughter escaped through the swinging door. It would have been easier if she was crying. Instead, Ginny stared, dry-eyed, her jaw working a little bit, grinding her teeth, or maybe trying to keep something shoved down. He couldn't think of anything else to do, so Lee cupped a hand over her shoulder. Her coat wasn't thick enough to keep her warm, not with the way she was shivering. It was a subtle movement, a thin hummingbird tremor, invisible until you got close. Real close. Ginny. He searched for the right tone, soft but firm. Sweetheart. It just slipped out, not like he hadn't already made himself plain, but still... There was always that moment you broke cover, even when there wasn't likely to be any shooting. That made a man nervous. Got her attention, though. She focused on him, big dark eyes swimming through the thousand-yard stare to focus.
How long?
She blinked and came back home.
What I mean is, did you ever come into the library when I wasn't working there?
It probably wasn't what she really wanted to ask, but he answered anyway.
Some.
When I needed me a Chilton's or to suss out a diagram.
When did you?
Maybe she didn't even know what she wanted to ask. He didn't have a clue why she was asking him now, but if it got that dull, fixed expression off her pretty face, he would give whatever answer she wanted to hear.
I saw you at Landy's. Kept my ears open and heard you were in town on Sundays. Decided I could do more reading.
It sounded simple, and in the beginning it had been. Just once, he'd told himself the first time. Then, when he was in the library, he felt like a fool and couldn't very well walk out empty-handed. Now could he? After that first time, there were always the books to take back, punctual, every week. It had taken him a month or two to begin reading any of them because he felt damn ridiculous just ferrying them around.
Oh.
Ginny nodded, slowly, as if he'd said something profound.
I wondered.
Probably wasn't all she was wondering.
I ain't a stalker, Miss Virginia.
Well, maybe he was, a little. But he had good intentions, right? All the way down to hell, Nana would have said. Lord, but he wished Nana was on hand to give him a few pointers. Of course, she'd just tell him he was being a fool, which was nothing Lee Quartine didn't already know.
No.
Ginny's dark gaze sharpened even more. I believe you. Good. Slow and steady was called for here.
I told you. I ain't gonna push neither. You don't have to do a damn thing about it. I just let you know so you could... know.
Well, didn't that sound ridiculous, too? He was all but dressing up in clown shoes and a funny hat. Amazingly, she smiled. Just like sunrise. Lighting first in her eyes, then dimpling her cheeks and pulling up the corners of her mouth. Her lips looked glossy with chapstick. Was that what girls used nowadays? Hers was probably some expensive brand. I do know. I'm grateful for it, too. I'd probably be dead by now if you hadn't been there. He didn't want her thinking like that.
You're a smart girl, Ginny. You'd have done fine.
She shook her head. I keep reaching for my phone and being reminded there's no service. And in a little while, I probably won't be able to charge the damn thing either. There go most of my smarts. Everyone offloaded them into phones and pads, and now they're about as useful as bricks, except for whatever I downloaded.
Well, if that was a problem, he could fix it. They got solar chargers. Any outdoor store will have them.
You planning on breaking into one or two?
Ginny relaxed a little, then a little more.
Lee realized she was teasing him, gently, and had to swallow twice before his voice would work.
If the occasion calls for it.
Looking at her braids made him think of seeing her hair down, the curl to it, and its rippling length.
That was an image guaranteed to keep him focused. Not sure it's breaking in anymore, though.
Yeah. She leaned into his hand. Coast to coast, the television said. While we were having community meetings and drinking punch, the whole world was falling apart. The words bounced off painted concrete walls, fell flat.
Then we spit and bail and wire it back up. Easy enough.
In reality, it was never easy, but he wanted her to relax. Badly.
We're alive right now. I aim to keep it that way.
That's good. She nodded again thoughtfully. Her thin gold hoop earrings glittered. That's really good. But listen, Lee. What happens when one of us gets sick? Juju, me, or God forbid, you, start running a high fever. What happens then? Just because she'd been quiet didn't mean she wasn't chewing over the absolute worst that could happen. Lee was thinking she excelled at it.
If it ain't happened by now, it ain't likely to.
When she stiffened a little, he knew it was the wrong answer.
If it does.
When? She corrected. At least she wasn't leaning away from him.
If it does, I'll do what needs doing. And if it's me, Juju will. You can trust him.
That was a rare damn thing in the world, and he hoped she knew what he was trying to express. Maybe she did, but it didn't stop the worry train. Looked like it was an express. Great. What if it's me? He weighed the advisability of telling her about Grandin in his living room before all this started, about the paperwork and the syringes in their little foam-filled hard case, or telling her he had a good idea what was in them and that her parents were most likely gone already, unless they were damn tough, damn smart, and damn lucky, too. There was no way to say anything that wouldn't bring up even more questions, and the last thing she needed right now was another helping of uncertainty. Everything would go a lot easier if Miss Virginia Mills just learned she could trust him, too.
Nothing's gonna happen to you,
he managed. There was something in his throat. Felt like a rock coated with peanut butter, and Lee realized he was hungry.
I promise.
That's really nice. But you can't promise that, Lee.
Oh, yes, I can. And if you come down with the creaking fever, I'll send Juju on with the kids and...
He stopped right there, not willing to follow the thought all the way down. It went quietly. He suspected it would come back while he stood watch or tried to sleep to keep him company.
Yes, I can,
he said and pulled at her shoulder gently. She was reluctant, and he knew he was pushing it, but he got his arms around her, and it was exactly as he'd imagined, only better. Small and soft, and the smell of her shampoo on clean, dark braided hair. He could curl up around her like a shell on a turtle's back or a snail's hard, protective home. Make himself a wall. Shut his eyes, and anything that came would go through him first. Ginny relaxed, abruptly, her cheek against the chest of his shearling. He wished it was unbuttoned, and the flannel underneath. That would be right comfortable.
You got to quit worrying like that, Ginny. I need you to help run herd on the kids. And you can't do that if you're wasting yourself on dry fretting, all right? You leave the rest of it to me, you hear?
Mostly people settled right down when they had a clear-cut job in front of them, and she was already a dab hand at calming Steph down. It was over too soon. Mark let out a sharp bark of surprise. Steph laughed, and Ginny, reminded of their presence, pulled away. He wanted to keep hold of her, but that wasn't the right thing to do. And maybe because he didn't, because he let her go, she tipped her chin back and examined his face. Not quite as far away as she would be if she didn't like him at least a little. Right inside the invisible line that edged a man's personal space. And one thing was for sure. Lee was going to need a cold shower sometime soon. Jesus. Okay. A small, pale little word. We're a team now, right? All of us.
Including you, darling.
For some reason, that brought up another smile, the corners of her eyes crinkling and dimples beginning on her soft cheeks. Lee stood helpless and let it wash over him. Thank you, Lee.
And with that, she was on her way down the hallway again, moving with a bounce that hadn't been in her step before.
Like the weight had lifted, like she believed him. Like he'd made it better and for once hadn't put his foot so far down his own throat he was chewing on kneecaps. Lee exhaled, a long, drawn-out sound that wasn't quite a whistle or a word.
Yeah. Definitely a cold shower. Goddamn.
Wonder of the World.
They had some lettuce left over.
Steph plunked down what she hoped was a respectable-looking salad in front of Miss Mills and studied the older woman's expression with wide, anxious eyes.
The tomatoes were mealy because of the cold, and the iceberg was practically blanched, and the only thing she could think of was to put olives and grated cheese on for color, and a couple of cut-up apples she'd brought from home. She knew enough to rub lemon juice on apple slices so they wouldn't get brown, at least.
Used what I had, so perfect.
The lady librarian smiled, and it looked genuine. Of course, everything on her looked that way. Solid wood instead of plastic, real silver instead of the cheap, bright junk you got from the spinner at the drugstore with nasty old May Cooper watching you like a hawk to make sure you didn't take off with it.
It's so nicely arranged. You have an eye for this, Steph.
Steph's cheeks turned hot, and not from the grill.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, there's fried chicken and fries and cheeseburgers, too.
She didn't dare glance at Mark, who was nursing a bad burn on the pad of his left thumb.
We got orange juice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.